Hello, people that exist. That was very half-hearted. This is my review for The Battle of the Labyrinth by Rick Riordan. I read it yesterday. I rated this 5.4 stars in my insane rating system. Sorry. And, well, this is... These were my thoughts for each chapter. Something on my lip. And then in chapter one, as a reviewer said, like one of the reviewers on Goodreads, the attraction between characters also plays a large part in the book, far more than the books before this in the series. Like more drama between him and Annabeth and Rachel and stuff. And then being embarrassed about your mom's date pestering, even if she is correct. Like, that also. So being sure that the reader knows he does not think about Rachel. All of those things. Before the crazy stuff starts to happen. Like, yay, Mrs. O'Leary. Triple G Ranch. Do I hear foreshadowing? And then Tyson is so wholesome and I love him. And Tyson is awesome. Stupid thing on my phone. And then a soul for a soul, like in his vision about Nico. Do I smell De Quintus shadowing? Like the Dallas, the Quintus. Yeah, stupid. Chapter 3. You found him a year ago. It was half a year from Percy found... this is talking about Tyson, I think. You found Tyson... someone a year ago. It was half a year from when Percy... When Percy found him to the Titan's curse. Then another half year to this. 1 year, not a few. I think it means Tyson. But I don't know. And then chapter 4, Quintus hopes he himself is dead. Spoilers, sorry. And the prophecy means, Nico and spoilers again. Because, for later in the book, it says, like, Quintus hopes Daedalus is dead, but, and the prophecy means Nico and Daedalus. Chapter 6. Ah! Not Hera! Janice is at least not as evil. Then chapter 7. Can't imagine how terrifying Pompey would be. Also, Briars is awesome. And also, a gun! Nice. Chapter 8. And Percy finally remembers. Took too long to remember what Triple G Ranch meant. Then with Geryon description of Quintus, and then he doesn't know Quintus. Yeah. Very convincing. And then, can I call you Nico? No. You see, Nico, Geryon is very obnoxious and rude. Then, finally, a useful naiad in chapter 9. Like a quote that... like a naiad that isn't being stupid. A naiad that actually wants to protect the place and also helping. And then end a quote, that wasn't Percy's fault. It's somewhere in this chapter. I just need to find it. Missing. Yeah, safe, Nico said. What do you care if I'm safe? You got my sister killed. And then Nico, Annabeth said, that wasn't Percy's fault. Percy's fault. Okay, yeah, I'm a grammar nerd. Daedalus was pretty evil that day when, he murdered his nephew. And most days he was pretty evil. But also, he was a genius. Then, chapter 11, monster puberty. Good lesson, Percy. And Typhon has been real... spoilers. Typhon, not Tyson. Obviously not. Sadness. So sad and worried about him leaving and thinking she is more beautiful than Aphrodite because of her natural beauty is totally valid. And then, chapter 13, I just noticed what Hera meant about Percy knowing Rachel Elizabeth there. A lone half-blood? Why, that might be Ethan Nakamura. Then, chapter 14. Nothing like that. But then, wolf! When Mrs. O'Leary just comes in. And then chapter 15. Nice roast day, Dallas. I forget exactly what it is. Chapter 15. Sorry. Once we're in Daedalus's web. Lessons from your friend on seeing clearly. Sorry for taking like a minute to figure that out. And then there's no way of holding back the might of Kronos. What about a blue plastic spoiler? Chapter 16. Rich kid? Yes, she is. And then such an epic introduction for Kronos, stepping out of a coffin and being completely unharmed from a blade designed to kill monsters, then not even touching someone and sending them flying. But then again, a plastic hairbrush did it. Okay, chapter 17. Pan makes me happy even from reading. Just the laugh makes me fill with glee. Pan's reveal is almost better than Kronos. It's just an old satyr in a bed, surrounded by beauty, natural beauty. And it's so sad when he dies. I can't even imagine what Grover felt. There's resolve too. And Grover, you can just put his elastic cap on. And I just whack my head. And, chapter 18, even in a tense battle, Ryan finds a way to make something funny, but not so much that it disrupts the battle scene. Tyson riding a giant and whacking it on the head, bong, 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 is hilarious. Grover panics, literally, then the enemy panics. This book, and even starting in The Titan's Curse, is far more mature than the books before it. The death of Zoe, the rising of Kronos, the death of Pan, and now the death of a murderer and a man who cheated death. Murderer, not murder. Chapter 19. Perry Johansson, Peter Johnson the 7th. And then chapter 20. Yeah, Hera is very, very jerky. And then, not like beef jerky, obviously. Pan should be better off dead. A ham, and then Paul Blowfish the 2nd. I really want to read The Last Olympiad. Okay. Thanks for watching. Bye.